Bonjour! Hi! Welcome to this new episode of Cloud in 5 Minutes. I'm Frank Boucher, Microsoft Cloud Advocate, and today I want to show you 10 tips to reduce your cost for your virtual machine, your VMs, starting right now. Et si vous préférez, j'ai aussi une version en français de ce vidéo. Vous avez seulement à cliquer ici, en haut à droite, pour être redirigé. Okay, so before we start with all the tips, I want to tell you that, of course, all the URL will be displayed in the screen, but I will put a list, very exhaustive list of all the links in the description. So let's start with step number one, picking the good size of VM or the good type of VM for your work. There's plenty of services that exist, and here it is a web page that exists. You can find it at akms/az-series. Here you have a lot of description on every type of families for your virtual machine. It's very important because some VM are built with more memory, other with more CPU, other GPU. So if you're doing machine learning, it's definitely not the same type of resource you need as if you're running an SQL database on it. And I hear you, of course, it's very difficult to pick the best VM for the work on the first try. So give it a try, go in a family, read the spec, and you can always adjust by scaling up and down after the VM is deployed. Of course, there will be a little downtime, but you know, it's worth a try. And sometimes the work is already there. We want to migrate our VMs. So for that, we have a page that exists. It's Azure Migrate that will help you a lot about getting tools and set and prepare your virtual machine for a migration. And if you're planning to migrate a Hyper-V VM, here's an excellent blog post from my friend Thomas that helps you to assess and migrate an Hyper-V VM. So with that, it will list all the information you need to get ready to migrate your Hyper-V machine in Azure. So the tip number two is to shut down the VM you don't use. It may look simple, but it will make a huge difference. Of course, it's only possible if it's not a web server or a database. So mostly for your dev and test VMs. When you create a virtual machine, in the tab management, if you scroll down at the bottom, you have an auto shutdown. You could set there and specify a schedule when you want your VM to automatically shut down. So very useful. So it could be at the end of every day and the weekend. Of course, if one or many VMs already exist, you could go in the portal and change this option. If you want to do it by batch, I show in a previous video that is available just here in the top right corner, a way writing a script to modify all those VMs at once. This way, all the VMs you decided will automatically shut down every night. So in tips number two, it was shutting down the VM you can, but what if you cannot shut down those VM. So tip number three, commit to reserve instances. So when you know a server will always be up and running, you should commit to a specific location and for a long period of time. If you go at bit.ly/az-reservation, you will find a documentation that explains all of that. By reserving your VM for a long period, let's say 2 years in a specific data center, the more precise you go in your reservation, the lower the cost will be. So it's a very good way to save money on server or VMs that you know will stay there for a long period of time. So the tip number four will be to pick the good type of VM. Previously, we spoke about the family series and stuff like that, but now it's more about the type. So of course, those types are part of series, but you know, let's keep it simple here. So what I mean is sometimes we have a server that will run for a long period of time using only very little resources, and suddenly we'll have a very high demand for a short period of time. This is when you want to use the burstable VMs. So those VMs will be perfect and will be able to quickly change size or having more resources for a short period of times. So if you're having something very likely to do this kind of things, you should consider using those type of VMs. And sometimes it's more we have a little job to run and we don't want to wait too much time to have the VMs available. So That's why the spot VM exists, where you could create a VM, process your things, and delete everything or stop it just after. So those VM will be perfect for any processes, you know, job process that you have. So my next tip will be to maximize your hybrid benefits. And by that, I mean stop paying twice for your license. A lot of time when you're using VMs, you already have license for your on-prem VM. So if you're planning to migrate those VM in Azure, or if you're not using anymore your on-prem or creating new VM with the same kind of software in Azure, you could reuse a lot of those license in Azure. To be sure that it's possible, go check the at bit.ly/AZ hybrid. In this page, you have all the information. But when you're creating a VM in Azure, there's a lot of VMs that are tagged BYOL, bring your own license. Those VMs can be created using the same license that you may already have. So it's definitely a good way to save some money by not paying twice for the same thing. So since the beginning, we're talking about creating smartly new resources, but what happens when the resources are created? How we can manage them? Well, you need to use the cost management. So you can find more about this tool at akms/azcostmanagement. Here you will have a lot of information about how to use it and what you can expect. In fact, you already have it. Let's switch to the Azure portal. And here from the Azure portal, you could always find your cost management. You will see pie chart and graph and a lot of information. In fact, in a next video, I will spend a lot more time showing you how to maximize this tool. But it's definitely something you should look at. So my next step is more when you don't really know what you should be looking for. So using the Azure Advisor. It's available at bit.ly/AZ Advisor. And here you have a lot of information about this incredible tool. And it's available directly again from the Azure portal. From the Azure portal, you have a lot of resources and information, recommendation about, yes, your virtual machine, your costs, but also the performance, your database, and tons of recommendation on all services. It's definitely a tool that you should have a look and revisit and revisit again and again. My next tips is about picking the good region for your VM. Of course, you always try to stay close to your customer or your data, but sometimes moving your VM in a specific region can impact a lot your cost. And right now, at the moment I'm recording this video, there's 56 region available in Azure. You could have all the details at bit.ly/AZ regions. And here you have all the information, all the location will be available. And by scrolling down just a little bit, you will have a menu here and you will be able to search your product and pick and see them by region. Because of course, not every product or feature is available in each region. So this way you will be able to see where it's available and adjust between your region and your needs. And here we are at tips number 9, getting out of your VM by configuring PaaS, platform as a service. VM are fantastic. They are very flexible because you could put anything you want inside of them, but you need to maintain them and they are a big block. By going smaller as a platform as a service or PaaS, you will a lot of time limit your cost and also have less thing to maintain because all the infrastructure will be maintained by Microsoft. To help you figuring out what you can do and what you can migrate, you could go to the Azure Migration Center. There will be a lot of information in that page and different tools available. Would it be by using the Migrate Application Service? So if you already have a website running in .NET or PHP or something like that, you could use this tool to do some assessments of your code and check if it's possible to migrate it. Or for example, if you need to do some little change, for example, if you had a memory session, it's probably a bad idea when you have multiple servers. So this tool will help you to list and migrate the code. Of course, there's also a tool that exists for your database, so the Data Migration Assistant will do an assessment of your database and then will even help you and do the migration of your database in a database as a service. It supports many different types of service and different kind of scenario of migration. It's very interesting. So there it is, the final tips. In fact, it's do some follow-up. Once your VM is created, you should monitor it. Question your choices. Could you pick a smaller VM? Could you reduce your use? Could you turn off that VM? You should use at the maximum. It's not normal if your VM is running only at 50% CPU. It's not normal. You should maybe think about moving a second application in that same VM or reducing the size of this VM. So every VM should be used at closest as possible at the maximum capacity. This video was strongly inspired from an article. In fact, when I read this blog post from my friend Thomas Maher, I thought, you know, I need to do a video about that thing. So the video, the link of this blog post will be also in the description, but here it is, and it's mostly the same thing that I just explained to you. And voila, that was my 10 tips to reduce your cost for your VMs. I hope you liked the video and I hope it was useful. Don't forget to share, subscribe, click the bell icon so you know when the new video is coming up. If you have any question, don't hesitate to contact me on all social media or write it down in the comment section. And talking about comments, let's read a few of them. So the first question comes from Edson Pacheco, is asking, hey Frank, how can I extract unzip file that are password protected? I have the password, but I don't know how I can use that. Well, that was part of the video where I was using Logic App. So in Logic App, the connectors is very limited. I don't think there's a way to do it. You will need to do it probably by code. So my assumption will be you're better watching my second video that I will put the link in the description where I'm using Azure function, so code to unzip the file. This way you'll probably be able to pass the password and then be able to unzip your protected zip file. So the next questions come from Today Pro that is asking, ARM template versus Terraform, which one make more sense? That's the question, my friend, an excellent question. However, I don't have any knowledge about Terraform. I heard about that. There's pros and cons, I think, in ARM template and Terraform. I really like ARM template and I think it's worth it spending more time with it. In fact, I will do a full series soon about how to build your ARM template and all the tools and everything. So I'm biased, but I would say ARM template is really interesting. However, I don't think Terraform is bad either. It's just, I think it's a question of choice. So yeah, sorry, that's the answer I have. And the last questions of today come from Joker. In fact, bunch of X1 Joker is asking, hey Frank, does this authentication system work for a Blazor web app? Many thanks anyway. So that was a question based on my last video when I was saying how about authenticate your user on a web app using social login. So of course, Joker, there's no problem using that. I just used the MVC because it was easier. It's possible to use it with Blazor. In fact, I'm looking forward to try it and test it. So maybe a new video coming soon. Maybe I'll probably wait until the version is GA though. But yes, it's possible. It's possible with many different languages. But great question. Voila, that's it for this week. I hope you like it. Don't forget, subscribe, like, share, click the bell icon to know when I have a new video, and see you next time. Thank you for watching. Bye.